This video was made possible by CuriosityStream. Watch thousands of high-quality documentaries and get access to Nebula using the link in the description. By the 1960s, the idea that a jet could take off and land vertically was no longer the stuff of science fiction, and freeing jets from needing runways was going to revolutionize their use. While the British led the way with the first jump jet fighter, Germany set out to build something even more ambitious, the world's first vertical jet lift transport, combining the speed and range of a jet with more vertical lifting power than just about any helicopter in the world. This was a plane that would revolutionize Germany's Air Force, a truly versatile machine that could even redefine air travel itself. But developing the world's first VTOL jet transport would be fraught with technical challenges. It's called vertical takeoff and landing, or VTOL, and getting a jet to do it would prove to be one of the most difficult challenges in aviation history. Without forward motion, a plane's wings can't generate any lift, and it means a VTOL jet must rely entirely on its engines to get airborne by directing thrust downwards. But making enough power to lift off vertically is only part of the challenge. Jet thrust must also keep the aircraft stable and oriented, because while hovering, conventional control surfaces aren't able to control the aircraft. And a VTOL jet still needs to fly like a conventional plane. And one approach is to use dedicated lift jets to get airborne and a separate jet for conventional forward flight. Another approach is to develop an engine that can do both, vector thrust downwards for vertical lift and rearwards for forward flight. A third way is to combine dedicated lift jets and vector thrust. These were enormous engineering challenges, but throughout the 1960s, several countries launched VTOL jet development programs, because freeing jets from needing runways could make all the difference in the next major conflict. During the Second World War, a grass field was just about all that military aircraft needed to get airborne. Grass fields are hard to destroy and easy to replace, and a World War II-era fighter needed only a few hundred feet of it to get airborne. But in little over a decade, that all changed, because jet aircraft needed thousands of feet of concrete runway to get airborne, creating a strategic vulnerability. In the opening hours of a conflict, runways were going to be the first targets, and their destruction would render an entire air force inoperable. During the Cold War, nowhere was this vulnerability more apparent than in West Germany, where most air bases were just a few hundred kilometers from Soviet bloc countries, within easy striking distance of aircraft and cruise missiles. But VTOL jets could operate without runways, and for West Germany, the technology seemed like the perfect solution, because aircraft could be stationed throughout the country, away from threats, kept hidden under the cover of forests or inside buildings. Aircraft could even use the country's Autobahn highway network to stage operations. In 1960, West Germany set out to build an air force around VTOL technology, starting with the development of a supersonic fighter with unique pivoting wingtip jet engines. A year later, work also began on a VTOL strike fighter, a ground attack aircraft to serve as the mainstay of the West German Air Force. But critical for supporting these aircraft out in the field would be a jet lift transport, a plane that could deliver supplies and personnel to remote forward operating bases. And in 1962, West German aircraft builder Dornier was assigned the enormous challenge of developing it. Getting a jet to lift off vertically was difficult enough. A VTOL transport would also need to lift several tons of cargo. And to do it, engineers would need to develop everything from new flight control systems, engine layouts, to avionics. This is the Dornier Do-31, the world's only vertical jet lift transport. Using the combined power of two vector thrust turbofans and eight lift jets in wingtip pods, the Do-31 could generate an incredible 66,000 pounds of thrust, more vertical lifting power than just about any helicopter in the world. To keep the aircraft stable, engineers developed an advanced computerized flight control system, working around the limits of 1960s technology with an innovative part-digital, part-analog hybrid computer. In forward flight, the lift jets would be shut off, and the Do-31 would fly like a conventional plane. And it could reach speeds of over 700 kilometers an hour and carry 36 fully equipped troops or nearly 6 tons of cargo. An unprecedented combination of speed, range, and lifting capacity. But developing the world's first VTOL jet transport would be fraught with technical challenges. And it took Dornier almost 5 years to develop the Do-31's technologies. But by 1967, confidence in the aircraft was growing. And soon, test flights were proving that Germany's jet lift transport was more than capable of fulfilling its design mission. And as Dornier moved closer to a production version, some even saw the potential for vertical jet lift technology to revolutionize commercial aviation. Because VTOL airliners would operate from helipads, maybe even directly from building rooftops. But VTOL jet travel was going to have to wait. As the 1960s drew to a close, the Cold War evolved into a new phase. An all-out war with the Soviet Union now seemed less likely, and it meant the development of VTOL-capable jets was less of a strategic priority. And getting a jet to reliably take off and land vertically proved to be far more challenging and dangerous than originally anticipated. By 1968, it was clear that Germany's VTOL fighter jet wasn't going to meet its design objectives, and with rising development costs, the program was canceled. And that put the future of the Do-31 in doubt. More than anything, what West Germany needed was a partner to help shoulder development costs. And while Dornier managed to get the attention of the US military and aerospace industry, partnerships never materialized. Like other VTOL jets, the Do-31 had some serious limitations. Sure, its 10 jets could lift more than just about any helicopter in the world. Much of what they were actually lifting was the aircraft's own weight. 10 jets and the fuel needed to keep them all running made the Do-31 incredibly complex and heavy. And the noise would have been a deal-breaker for any civil application. Dornier tried to impress crowds at the 1969 Paris Air Show, flying alongside Britain's Harrier Jump Jet in a coordinated aerial display. But excitement over VTOL was starting to fade, and the plane garnered little in the way of serious interest. And without a development partner or buyers, Dornier was forced to cancel the project in 1970. The attack aircraft it was intended to support would eventually suffer a similar fate. Of the many VTOL projects launched in the 1950s and 60s, most would end in failure. Unable to overcome monumental engineering challenges, were the inherent limitations of jet lift technology. The world's only jet lift transport promised to combine the speed and range of a jet with the versatility of a helicopter, a machine designed to address a pressing strategic challenge. Decades earlier, Japanese engineers were also trying to solve their own strategic problem. And their solution would be to combine the stealth of a submarine with the strike capabilities of an aircraft carrier. Japan's underwater aircraft carriers were some of the most fascinating machines to come out of the Second World War. And you can learn their incredible story in my latest video, which you can watch right now on Nebula, a streaming platform created by some of YouTube's top educational creators. It's a platform without advertisements, recommendation algorithms, or sponsor messages. And it's where creators are free to experiment with new kinds of content,